something to do with testing. And so with that, let's hear from Peter.
Okay, thank you. So this is a joint work with Katharina Urban from my group and Samuel Ulci, who was a master's student here at ETH. And we are interested in using EBSCIC interpretation to check CTL properties. So as you're probably familiar, CTL, or computation tree logic, is a branching time logic, so a temporal logic that allows you to consider different futures. And so the core formulas that we have in CTL are, wait a second, I'm struggling with my microphone here. Okay, so the core formulas are atomic propositions. We have negation, conjunction, and disjunction. And then for the temporal operators, they all come in two forms, a universally quantified form that talks about all possible futures, and an existentially quantified form that talks about the existence of at least one possible future that satisfies the formula. So we have the next operator, so for all possible executions in the next state, phi is going to hold, and we have the equivalent for the existential. We have a strong until, which says that the second formula here will hold eventually, and until that's the case, the first one will hold, again in the universal form and an existential form. And we have the generally or always operator that says that a formula holds in all future states, and again for all futures or just for some of the futures. So here on the right you see just two small examples to get used to it. So here we have the different futures represented as trees. And for instance, the one on the left here satisfies the formula that in all futures, we have true until black. So black holds eventually. And until then, well, true holds trivially. So that's the case on all futures. So here we have it, and here we have it as well. On the right, we have an existential formula, so we know that there exists at least one future in which black holds eventually, and until that's the case, blue holds. So that's this future here. And so we're interested in using EBSCIC interpretation to automatically check CTL properties of programs. And we go beyond earlier work in this area by inferring sufficient preconditions that guarantee that the formula actually holds. So when this inferred precondition is true, it will always hold. If it's false, it will never hold. And otherwise, it tells you in for which starting state the formula is guaranteed to hold. Hmm?
Is this a minimal set, or could you express the until in terms of the others, or could you
express
the others?
This is not necessarily a minimal set, but that's what people usually use as the core of CTL, and you have more operators that you can encode into this.
Okay.
And we also handle existential properties which are not fully supported by earlier work. So let me introduce a small running example to illustrate our technique. So in this running example, we have a loop that iterates an arbitrary number of times. So for every loop head, we flip a coin, and then either we do another iteration or we terminate. In the loop body, we set x to 1, increment y, and set x to 0. And after the loop, we run into a non-terminating loop. So you could, for instance, imagine that setting x to 1 corresponds to acquiring a lock. Setting it back to 0 could correspond to releasing a lock. And the formula that I will use for my examples is the following. We want in all futures the property that x equals 0 holds eventually. All right? And so if we check this specification on this program, we will infer the specification or the precondition x is equal to 0. And you see that we actually need that. First of all, if x is 0 initially, this formula certainly holds, right? Because this is true right from the start. And on the other hand, if x is not 0 initially, then it could happen that this loop here, the first loop, iterates 0 times, and then x will actually never be 0, and the formula doesn't hold. So you really need this kind of precondition. So we do this by EBSCIC interpretation. So our starting point is to define a concrete semantics. And we do that by starting from a so-called maximal trace semantics that contains all the finite and infinite traces that your program can produce. So in order to do that, we transform the program into a control flow graph. So you see 5 program points now with the transitions between them. So this is the first loop here, and this is then the second loop down there. And then the maximal trace semantics contains all the traces. Here are 4 of them, but there are, of course, infinitely more. So for instance, this first trace starts in a state where x and y are both 0, iterates the first loop 0 times, so immediately goes to program point 5, and then x is going to be 0 and y is going to be 0 forever. The third one here is a trace that shows that the property does not hold for all executions. So if x is initially 2 and y is 3, and the first loop iterates 0 times, then we will stay in this state forever, and x will never be 0. Okay, so that's one of the traces that we would like to rule out with our precondition. So now, based on this maximal trace semantics, what we do is we define a concrete program semantics that is specific to a given CTL formula that we want to check. So given such a formula phi and a set of program traces from a given starting starting state, we define a partial function lambda from states to ordinals. So this partial function expresses two things. The more important aspect is the domain of that function. And so the domain of that function tells us for which states the formula actually holds. So if a starting state is in the domain of this partial function, then the formula phi holds for this starting state. So that's the important information. The second information we get out of this function is that if the formula phi is an until formula, then the value returned from this function, so the ordinal number, is a ranking function. So intuitively, it counts how many execution steps we will have to take until phi 2 here actually holds. So if I go back to my example here on the right, if I look at the formula like before, x equals 0 must hold eventually, and I look at this first program state here, then lambda of the starting state will be 0 if x is initially 0, right? So that means in that case it's defined and the formula actually holds immediately. And it's undefined in all other cases, because for all other cases it's possible that the execution takes this branch and x will never be 0. And since we have a universal quantification there, that is a possibility that we need to consider, and so we are undefined in all other cases. We don't know whether the formula holds. If I look at an existential formula, so I do, there exists a future in which x equals 0 holds eventually, then my lambda will also give me back 0 in case x is initially 0, because again, the formula holds immediately, trivially, so to say. And in all other cases, it's also defined, because in all other cases, there exists an execution, namely the one that goes down there, that after 3 steps reaches a state in which x is definitely going to be 0. Okay, so here you see this aspect that we really count the number of steps there so that we have this kind of ranking function. And now, basically, that gives us a concrete semantics, right? That is defined on the concrete traces of the program. And now, if you want to build a static analyzer that checks CTL properties for us, we need to find a suitable abstraction of that concrete semantics that we can actually compute. And in order to do that, we build on earlier work by Katharina Urban and Antoine Menet. They used piecewisely defined ranking functions in order to abstract such functions. So let me give you a quick introduction of how these piecewise defined ranking functions work. So on the left here, you have such a piecewise defined function. So this function, as I've written down here in mathematical notation, will yield 4 if the argument x is greater or equal 4. It gives you 7 minus x if x is less or equal 2. And between 2 and 4, it's undefined. So it's a partial function. And this abstract domain represents such piecewise defined functions as decision trees. So decision trees are trees, like here on the right, where the leaves are affine functions, and where the inner nodes are conditions that we can represent in some abstract domain. So in this particular work, in our experiments, we use polyhedra to represent those constraints, but we could use arbitrary abstract domains here. So you can read this as, if this condition is true, then the function gives you the value on the left. Otherwise, you go to the right. If this condition is true, so this one is false and this one is true, you get that value. Otherwise, you get the one on the right. So if this is false and this is false, the function is undefined. So this represents exactly what we have over here. So this is an existing abstract domain, and we leverage this domain in order to check CTL properties. So the actual analysis is actually quite complicated, and if you want to know the details, you can look it up in our paper at SAS this year. So in this talk, I will give you like a high-level intuitive overview of how it works, and I hope that you will get the idea. So in general, what we will do is we will define a static analysis which at each program point computes a piecewise defined function that over approximates this lambda function that I introduced before. So in particular, if my piecewise defined abstract function is defined, the underlying lambda function will also be defined, and we know that the property holds. And the way the analysis works is we do it as a backward analysis, and for the CTL formula, we do it kind of inside out. We start with the constituent formulas and then combine those results for the whole formula. So let me show you how this is done. So we will look first only at a portion of our formula, namely just the atomic proposition x is equal to zero. And we go back to our program that we've seen before. And now for an atomic proposition, it's very easy to define this abstract function. So I do this graphically. So what you see that, for instance, in this state, the formula holds if x is already zero. So there's a gray dot here. I hope you can see this. It's a bit difficult to spot. So if x is zero, this is defined and the value is zero. Okay. And for all other values of x, this is undefined. Okay. And for an atomic proposition, this is the same no matter in which state we are. So we have the same abstract function here. We have the same abstract function there, and so on. The interesting part is when we go to the larger formula, to the until formula. So let's do that. So now we look at the entire for all true until x equals zero. So what we can do is we can start with an arbitrary abstract function for our atomic proposition x equals zero and start iterating through the program. So let's, for instance, start here. So this is what we got for x equals zero. If x is zero, it's defined. Otherwise, it's undefined. So that's, of course, immediately a fixed point for that inner loop because nothing's happening here. And so we can push it back in the backwards analysis. And so we also get the same property here. So if x is zero, we are good. Otherwise, it's undefined. So now we cannot continue the backwards analysis because we also need a result for that branch here. So we start from another program point. Again, it doesn't matter which one. Let's take this one. So here we also had the property that if x is zero, the function is defined. And now we can move this backwards in the backward analysis. So if I go one step back, I get the following. If x happens to be zero in this state here, then the formula holds. Right, and it holds in zero steps because x is already zero. In all other cases, the formula will hold in one step. Namely, at one step, I assign zero to x, and then it definitely holds. So I get a function that is defined everywhere. It's at 1.0, and everywhere else, it's 1. So now I can push this further up in the control flow graph. So here I get a function that is where it's zero if x is zero, and otherwise it's two steps, this assignment and that assignment. And then I can go one step further, and I get the analogous thing. So now the interesting thing is what we do at this merge point here, right? So now we come with one abstract function from this path and one abstract function from that path. So now the point is that we have a universally quantified formula. So you want, so the property here needs to hold on all future executions, no matter whether we go this way or we go that way. And what that really means is that when we do the merge must preserve the undefinedness. Right? The undefinedness is the conservative way. It says the formula might not hold. And if this one says the formula might not hold, and this one says, well, it will always hold, well, because we have the for all, we need to consider the case that we go this way, and in fact, it might not hold. So the undefinedness needs to be preserved. And if we do that, then that's what we get from the merge. So we get a function that is zero if x is zero and undefined everywhere else. Okay, now we can continue to go around the loop in our backwards analysis. So we go along this edge and end up here. And this is actually where we started. So we have already reached the fixed point. And this is the result of our analysis. And you see this corresponds exactly to the precondition that I told you initially. So now our precondition is x must be equal to zero because the function is undefined everywhere else. So the CTL formula might not hold anywhere else, actually. All right, so in this example, I had a non-deterministic choice here because my loop flipped the coin to decide whether it continues to iterate. It's actually interesting for this analysis to discuss what happens for normal conditional statements instead of non-deterministic choices. So for that, I use a slightly different example. So my program is, if x is greater or equal to, then I assign 1 to y, and otherwise I assign 0 to y. And the formula that I care about is that I want in all futures y to be eventually equal to 1. Okay, so we see that this will hold in some cases and not in others. So we run the same kind of analysis, so that means at this program point, we get a function that tells us that now we have two variables in our state, x and y, but in my charts, I only show you the thing for x, so otherwise I would get a three-dimensional chart and all we need here really is x, so I project out y and I only show you the result for x here. So we know that for all values of x, it is the case that after exactly one step, this formula will hold. Okay? Similarly, if we go to this statement here, we'll get a function that is undefined everywhere, because if we run the program from here, there's no value of x that guarantees that y will be initially 1. All right? And now the question is again, in the control flow, now we reach the merge point, right, the conditional, and the question is, how should we actually do that? So what we're doing is the following. We represent this function by a decision tree, that's the constant 1 here, also this one, which is always undefined. Okay, so now if we just combine the two the same way as we did for the non-deterministic choice and say undefinedness always wins, we would have a very, very imprecise analysis. We would get undefined everywhere, even though the property clearly holds on at least some of the executions. So what we need to take into account, of course, is the loop condition here, the if condition here. And so if we do that, we can basically say, well, that part of the function is not really relevant, right? Because we only go into this statement if x is greater or equal to, so those values just don't matter. And we represent those in our decision trees by putting a condition here and a nil value saying basically this doesn't matter, this is irrelevant. And similarly, down there, all the values greater or equal to don't matter, right? So we can represent this also by a condition like this. And now the same rule applies. You merge the two functions, and wherever they overlap, the undefinedness wins. And that, in this particular case, gives you this function. So for x greater or equal to, it's defined, and the value is 2. For all values less than 2, it's undefined. Okay? And therefore, I can represent this as a decision tree, and that is the precondition that I have for this code snippet. Right, which is of course completely intuitive. If that condition holds, then y will eventually be 1. So now this example was very simple because in this example I have an if condition here that I can precisely represent in my condition here. Right, this is just an inequality, or I could even represent this in intervals, and that's what I can do with my constraints over there. So let's make the example a bit more interesting. Let's assume we still use some standard relational domain, say polyhedra, but not a parity domain. But let's now assume that our condition is more complicated, so it also includes that x is supposed to be even. So now if we do the same reasoning again, nothing has changed in the backwards analysis, so these two functions are exactly like before. And now the question is, how do we get to this merge point? Well, we have these two representations, and now we need to gray out everything that is not relevant. So here, everything that is less than 2, and all the odd numbers, right? So we would get something like this. And similarly, in the else branch, we have to gray out everything that's not relevant. So these are all the numbers that are greater or equal to and even. Right, and also that I can represent. But now I just said, let's assume we work with an abstract domain that cannot represent parity, so we cannot actually represent this in our abstract state. So what we need to do is we need to over-approximate, and that's exactly what we're doing. We over-approximate that formula, so we make it more true, so to say. So we get x greater or equal 2 over here, and we get just true down there. Okay, and that's where the abstraction comes in. And now I have again something that I can represent, and now the same rules kick in, so I merge those two trees, and wherever they overlap, undefinedness wins because I have a universal quantifier there. Right, so if I do that, then this is what I get. I get a function that is undefined everywhere, which is a pity because it tells us the formula doesn't hold, but our abstract domain is just not precise enough to figure out that in some cases it will actually hold. Okay, so the reason why I discuss this in so much detail is because this is what's really interesting when we switch to existential quantifiers. So let me look at a very similar example. There are only two changes. I changed the quantifier here to an E, so I want at least one future in which Y will eventually be one. And I changed this into a disjunction to get the behavior that I need to demonstrate what I want to demonstrate. So I'll walk you through the example again. So these things have not changed. So that's coming from the backwards analysis. And now we want to merge the two. So like before, we represent those as decision trees. We gray out the parts that are not relevant, right? So that means here we want x greater equal 2 or x is even. And the same down there. So all these steps are exactly like before. Right? So now we can also continue like before. We can say, well, this is information we cannot represent in our domain. So we over-approximate. So that turns this formula into true. And this formula to x equals 2. And now we need to merge the two. But now when we merge, we have an existential quantifier. So if there is only one execution that satisfies the formula, that's actually good enough. So therefore, when we merge the two, now definedness wins. For all the undefinedness always prevailed, for the existential, the definedness wins. So what we get is the following. We get a function that is always defined and always gives you the value 2. And you see, that's clearly unsound, right? Because executing this program does have executions in which this is not the case, right? If y is not initially 1 and you take the else branch, then y will never be 1. So by just doing the same stuff that I did before for the universally quantified formula, again, now it doesn't work because we have an existentially quantified formula. Intuitively, why is that? Well, if we over-approximate those conditions, that means we shift the balance more to the left, right? More to the defineness or the undefinedness, away from the irrelevant. There's less gray area there. When we then have a for all, we say undefinedness wins. And undefinedness is always conservative, right? We always say, well, the formula might not hold, and that's always sound, okay? But now for an existential formula, the definedness wins. So if we move this more towards the left, the definedness wins more often, and even in cases where it shouldn't, in cases that only come in because of the abstraction, but not because of the actual program semantics. So what that kind of reasoning shows is what we need to do in order to be sound here is we need to under-approximate. So we need to shift the balance here to the right and have more gray area such that we don't get this kind of unsoundness here. So this is the same situation as before, just before we did the abstraction. But what we actually need to do is we need to under-approximate, so we need to make the formula more false. So in this particular case, this is what we get then. So you see the gray area gets larger, and also here, the gray area gets larger. In fact, this is now a function that is completely irrelevant. Right? And now we merge the two again, and during merging, since we have an existential, definedness wins, and we end up with this function here. So if x is greater or equal 2, then we know the formula definitely holds. Right, and that's actually sound here. It actually holds in more situations, but those we lost due to our abstraction. But at least we find out if the first disjunct is true, the formula will always hold. And so now with the under-approximation here for the existential formulas, we actually achieve a sound result. So we have a soundness result, of course. We formalized that and proved soundness. So the soundness theorem essentially says that a program satisfies a CTL formula phi if all the traces starting from initial state sigma, for all the traces starting from initial state sigma, if sigma is in the domain of this lambda function, and the lambda function is in the concretization of this abstract function that we just defined as piecewise defined ranking function. Okay, so that's the function our static analysis computes. If we concretize that, we get this lambda from the concrete semantics, and if our state is in the domain of that function, then the state will actually satisfy the CTL formula. So we implemented that in the function analyzer, which is an analysis for a subset of C that Katharina Urban has developed during her PhD. It's also open source if you want to play around with it. And so then we evaluated our CTL analysis on various benchmarks. We took some test cases, we took some benchmarks from various papers and PhD theses, and we looked at some SV comp competition examples. And so in this implementation, we used polyhedra to represent the constraints of our decision trees and affine functions and ordinals for the leaves, so for the actual representation of the functions. And let me quickly show you what the results look like. So here are some of the benchmarks that we run. So on the left here, you see the formulas. You don't need to go into the details, but you see some of them are quite simple. Some of them are more complicated with nested quantifiers and so on. In the second column, you see whether our analysis produced the right result. So obviously, a green tick is a good example, and a red cross means we were not able to verify a property, even though it holds. And in the rightmost column, you see the analysis time. When these are all very small examples, but for those examples, the analysis is super fast. So we also compared that to two state-of-the-art tools, namely T2 and the Ultimate LTL Automizer. And so for T2, it actually turned out that there were a couple of examples we did not manage to run because it has a different input format and the translation into the input format turned out to be difficult. For those that we were able to run, for two of them, T2 produced the right result. For the others, T2 actually failed to verify the examples. On the other hand, the LTL Automizer did extremely well for all those examples that fall into LTL. Right, so not every CTL formula can be represented in LTL. For those who can, the LTL Automizer always gave us the right answer. But you see that there are many formulas, the ones with the minuses here, that were just simply not in LTL. And we have roughly another 20-25 more benchmarks that I omitted from this slide. On all the additional benchmarks, the three tools produced the same results. Okay, so here I only show the ones where there's actually a difference, but that might seem like I'm misrepresenting what some of the tools do. So there are like 20-25 additional examples where all tools do the same. Here I just wanted to highlight the differences. All right, so let me summarize. So what we developed is a theory for analyzing CTL properties in abstract interpretation. So with that, we can automatically infer sufficient preconditions. The benchmarks show that the analysis works reasonably well. In those cases where it didn't work well, it was almost always the widening of the piecewise defined function domain that caused some imprecision that then led to trouble. And so as future work, we are interested in extending this work to also cover LTL, which so far we cover only partially. And with that, I'm done. Thank you.
Let's thank Peter. We can take some questions.
Thank you. That's interesting tool to check out. I wonder, have you evaluated the negative cases? Like in this evaluation, I saw, is it able to prove the formulas that hold? How about the formulas that don't hold? Does it, how quickly can it report that they don't hold, and can it provide a counterexample, for example?
Okay, so thanks for this question. So all the examples were such that the formulas hold. So we expect to see only green ticks here. And whenever we see a red cross, that's a weakness of our analysis, right? The analysis is designed to be sound. Of course, modular bugs in the implementation, but it's a sound analysis. So it will find all the examples that don't hold, and we did not empirically evaluate the soundness. So we just assume that our theoretical soundness result actually holds. If you see a violation, you don't get a counterexample. So all you do basically is you basically infer false as a precondition, or maybe just a too strong precondition compared to what you actually need. And that's all. So then you have to take it from there.
Other questions?
Do you have any intuition about why these results are the way they are? Like, what was hard in those formulas, even though LTL atomizer could actually prove them. Specifically, I would suspect that you're doing an excellent job. It's just that these are not pre-processed to get into a normalized form, and that's why the LTL atomizer, I mean, it does some standard pre-processing,
yeah.
But not that otherwise you have any worse absolute interpretation. I guess your static reasoning is as good, if not better. My suspicion would be that you can probably get all those examples without ease, the ones that are in LTL.
Yeah, so possibly. So we checked that. We checked, of course, all the examples that didn't verify in the end. For almost all of them, it was really specifically the widening of our decision tree domain, which is something that the LTL automizer doesn't use. Right? It's possible that even though the way our analysis is constructed, it's in principle able to verify these things, but maybe the domain there is just too weak and we should consider alternatives. We also have a slight problem with the backwards analysis for non-deterministic choice, which we know how to fix, but just hadn't fixed by the time we ran these experiments. But that's all we found out so far.
So I was wondering, Vardy and Koskinen, I think, or some, they worked on this problem of, I think, CTO verification, where they were, compiling the property into the program.
Yeah.
Maybe Tito is doing this, they just take the program and then they compile it into the program. And then they use whatever off-the-shelf verifiers there are. Did you guys look at this, trying to basically compile the property into the program with some prophecy variables or some auxiliary variables?
No, we did not do that. So actually, many of our benchmarks come from Eric's thesis.
Uh-huh.
So we did look at his work, but we did not specifically look into the way he does the analysis.
Uh-huh. But that's what he was doing there, compiling it into mm-hmm. it. Yeah.
I know that this is actually what T2 implements, so it's not Eric's implementation, but it's a re-implementation of Eric's work. And I think this is, I maintain T2, and I know the thing that always breaks is this pre-processing. So I would expect that almost all of these things are mistakes in the compilation that T2 does when it edits the program to include the prophecy variables.
Mm-hmm. Okay, but that's helpful. Thank you.
Other questions for Peter? If not, let's thank Peter again.
Thank you.